here. Ready? I'm Chris Bryan. I'm a writer here in town. Thank y'all for coming out to hear Greg Hrbek visiting us from lovely Saratoga Springs, New York. A year ago, almost to this day, I was in New York roaming around after a meeting and looking for, kind of trolling bookstores and looking for examples of books that married, you know, the sort of the best things of literary naturalism with the kind of the tools of science fiction or dystopian fiction or the fantastic. And I stumbled across the book Greg is going to be reading from tonight, and it's shelved in the science fiction section, maybe rightly, maybe wrongly, of a book on of a shop on the Upper West Side, and something about it really kind of grabbed me. It's like, oh, this is the kind of thing I'm looking for. And it was that and more. It was really, it's an amazing book that seems all the more amazing, you know, in the context of today's news. It's a not on fire, but burning. Greg's first novel with an equally, maybe even more awesome title was The Hindenburg Crashes Nightly, which won the James Jones First Novel Award. And then I believe it has a collection, the also fantastic title, Destroy All Monsters. And Greg is distinguished artist in residence at Skidmore College. He's a writer in residence at Skidmore College. He teaches at Skidmore College and is a graduate of the Writers Workshop in beautiful Iowa City, Iowa. And we're very lucky to have him come down here and read to us from Not on Fire, but Burning. So thanks, Greg.
Hey, thanks a lot for coming. So I'm going to try to give as little context for this as I think is possible. And I'm going to start by reading the first couple of pages, so I'm not going to say anything about that, and then I'll say a little bit as I read a few short sections jumping around. So maybe I will say, you know, Chris mentioned that, I don't know, there's a certain topicality to this. But I, you know, it was published in hardcover in 2015, the end of 2015, and I finished writing it in 2014. She saw the impact, but Noah must have seen the object coming. From the next room where he had been playing Monopoly by himself, he said, "Skylar, look." "What?" "Skylar, look." He was 5 years old, and Skylar Wakefield had been his babysitter since she started college a year ago now. In a few weeks, classes again. She was ready to declare her major. She was going to be a fiction writer like her father. This is what she had been thinking in the moments before it happened, like my father. Then she looked. The house, set on one of the city's hills, had views of San Francisco Bay and the Golden Gate Bridge and the Marin headlands on the far side of the bay. What Skylar saw through the window confused her. A plane, but not a plane. It was too bright. Like something cosmic come at high speed through the atmosphere, a star falling in broad daylight, but now decelerating strangely like a machine, as if to land in the water of the bay. Then not landing, slowing and lifting, all of this happening very quickly as it approached the bridge, seeming to shrug its wings like some impossible dragon, though there were no wings, and yet something, metal or fire, or a bolt of electromagnetism, was severing the suspension cables. And as each red cable lashed whip-like into the air, the roadway fell by stages to the pure morning blue of the water. More than a crash, not an accident. Get away from the window, knowing what was coming now. Skylar put her back to the wall, shut her eyes hard, and tried to shout to Noah. But her voice was gone from the terror of knowing. Even with eyes closed, she could see the flash of light. If he's looking, he'll be blind. A moment later, a shock of wind hit the house, and the sound of every window breaking, of flying glass, of glass shards being rifled into walls and furniture, chiming against objects held together by metallic bonds, was like the music of the world. Please know, glass, plane, dream, help now, mom, dad, Dorian. So the rest of that opening chapter follows these two characters, Skylar and this little boy that she's babysitting, after the destruction of the city. And then the book jumps ahead 8 years and refocuses on Skylar's family. So those are the Wakefields. So in the story, something strange is happening to characters' memories, specifically Skylar's younger brother, Dorian, who's 11 years old at the time of the unfolding action, is dreaming of her, but his parents don't remember her, and they insist that she doesn't exist. So I'm going to read two sections on that subject. So first Dorian, and then his mom, who's named Catherine. Dorian says he had a dream about her, and then he waits like someone shipwrecked and marooned who has fired a flare into a dark sky. The colors of distress light up the room. His parents make believe they don't see. I have to get to work, his mother says, and hurries upstairs. Cliff is earphoned, that's his older brother. As for his father, it's summer. Classes have been over for weeks, and he is in between writing projects. Lost and miserable, convinced he will never conceive another fiction. He has nowhere in particular to be, but he turns to the stove clock as if the sight of the time will create an imminent deadline. 8:02. Dorian eases a spoonful of granola and milk into his mouth. His father removes his eyeglasses and holds them with the silver arms folded into an X. It is hip to wear glasses, to look like you come from another century, but no one actually has prescription lenses in the frames. There isn't a pair of eyes in the world whose imperfections haven't been corrected by laser beam, except for those of his father. When Mitchell Wakefield takes his glasses off, he literally can't see more than a foot in front of himself. Are you trying to upset her? No, but you know you are. The reason why, don't start that again, his father says. We've been through all of this. You promised, Dorian. All I said is, I had a dream. His father stares at him, not seeing him clearly, Dorian knows, seeing a blur, general shape of a sun. Then he puts the glasses back on, takes a deep breath and says, all right, tell me the dream. And Dorian realizes he doesn't want to tell it, hasn't brought it up for any good purpose. He knows perfectly well that his desire is to move the family backwards, back to the time last autumn, when he had accused his mother and father and brother of hiding everything from him. Everything. And after they'd responded with a show of ignorance and confusion, had felt justified in going totally nuclear on them. That's what he wants to do now. Because when he had shouted and cried and demanded they tell him the truth, the pressure, wherever it was coming from, had lightened a little. Now his father says, tell me, I want to hear. No, you don't. I do. I want to help Dodo. I don't need help. But he does. He does need help, just not the kind they are offering. If I keep this up, I'll wind up in that doctor's office again. So he says he's sorry, there was no dream. I don't know what my problem is. I'll say sorry to Mom. And he walks upstairs. The bathroom door is open a crack, and his mother stands before the mirror, drawing a dark line along the ledge of her lower eyelid. Faint scent of perfume in the air, he says nothing. He goes into his room and clicks the door shut, sits on his bed and turns on his pad and waits for her to at least knock, poke her head in and say goodbye so he can ignore the farewell or make a sound indicating that her departure means nothing to him. But she doesn't knock. He can see the end of the driveway from his window, the car turning onto the curb of the cul-de-sac and arcing out of sight. I should probably say when the story sets. So, when the explosion occurs in San Francisco, it's the year 2030. So this action that I'm reading now, 8 years later, is happening in 2038. So now I'm going to read a bit from his mom's point of view. And I'll just say that Dorian, in addition to possibly hallucinating a sister who never existed, is also experiencing some severe Islamophobia since the destruction of San Francisco has been blamed on Muslims, even though there's no consensus about actually what happened. So this is a chapter from his mom's, or section from his mom's point of view. On the drive home from work, think of Dorian, the baby he once was, the boy he is now, and the person you are frightened he will soon become. It seems you spend half your waking life these days on the Northway, backed up in traffic, worrying about the person your son might become, a hateful one who will pay hate forward. Hate, a strong word, but isn't it an accurate one? What he did on that school trip at the mosque. Heart hurts at the memory of reading those words, written in a hand undeniably his. Fuck Islam. What is that, if not hate? When all you've ever preached is love and respect for others, not through religion. You are not religious, though there was, when you first moved east, a brief flirtation with a Presbyterianism so open-minded it bordered on the agnostic. But in the socially progressive terms found in the messages of good books and the enlightened lessons of history. You cannot understand it, any more than you can understand why he sees a sister who never was. And though the two things, the emotion and the illusion, are surely interconnected, the question of which caused which is all but impossible to answer. Now this, a new boy across the street. When you heard the news that your neighbor has adopted an orphan from the camps, you thought, that's strange, because it isn't a thing you would expect from that man, whom you know and like well enough, but about whom you have heard, well, nothing specific or definite, only that he was one of those men who went to the war for money, and who, regardless of any crimes he might commit there, was guaranteed through the corruptions of occupying power to never see the inside of an indigenous courtroom. That was 3 decades ago, must be 70 years old now, a widower with no children, a man getting old alone, and now suddenly, a guardian, a father, who in giving this boy a home, will put a stop to the wrongs done him. Is this really so strange? If it seems so, it's merely because the world has become so warped that any act of kindness makes us look automatically for some counterwork of cruelty. The more you think about it, the more brightly a feeling sparkles in you. It's like a star appearing strong in a dark sky. Which brings us back to your son, who did not, in your opinion, learn anything from what happened back in the fall. After admitting to an act of vandalism, he served a 2-day suspension from school. On the first day, you took him back to the mosque, where he apologized to the imam and then covered over what he'd written with a fresh coat of paint. On the second day, he attended a half-day tolerance workshop for tweens sponsored by the hate crimes unit of the police department. And it was just a few days later, in the course of a conversation intended to bring some closure to the incident, that Dorian lost his temper and said he knew he once had a sister. And though he had forgotten for a long time, just as you all had wanted him to, she was coming back to him in dreams. And you couldn't hide it anymore. It had taken you quite a while to understand what in the world he was talking about. But as you absorbed the shock of the idea, you were thinking, not in words, but in a wave of feeling faster than words and more complete, that this claim was a deliberate invention, a way to deny responsibility and reflect blame back at you, as if you were the reason for his bad behavior and also the source of his prejudice. So he had learned nothing. In fact, he was only entrenching himself more completely in the kind of thinking that had to change. So that section is referencing this other important character who is a Muslim American boy who's been living in a detention camp. So a little bit of backstory. After this terror attack, which nobody knows if that's what it really was, the government sets up detention camps in the Great Plains, and they send specifically selected Muslim Americans there. And at the time of the story's unfolding action, Kareem is an orphan. His parents have died in the camp. And he's been using opium, and he's about to get out of the camp because he's been adopted by this neighbor of Dorian's, who is the 70-year-old ex-Marine and contract soldier, like a Blackwater guy, who lives in Dorian's neighborhood. That are connected. So one is Kareem, and then the other is this older guy, William Bamfelder. Two days later, dressed in donated clothes given him by the nuns. A pair of corduroys worn smooth at the knees, a collared shirt, bright red with an alligator stitched onto the left breast, a pair of tennis sneakers. He sits in a bus painted the blue of a bruise and rides out of the camp and onto a road so straight it might have been drawn on the plains with a ruler. The window of his seat is pushed up. A breeze comes through. On the horizon, he can see a rainstorm, a dark cataract of water plunging from a thunderhead as massive as an intergalactic mothership. The camp, that divided city, is already out of sight, and Hazem and Yassim won't ever see them again in this world. Next week, they leave for the Michigan Territory, a shelter for Muslim American youth where they can surely score a dream and probably play soccer all the livelong day, while you, in some heathen suburb, are getting the agonies and the shit kicked out of you. Kareem shuts his eyes and rests his left temple against the window sash. The wind goes right up his nose. It's like drowning. Like that time a couple years back when they were playing war and he was the terrorist, and they tipped him back on a board and poured water into his breathing passages. One of his friend's mothers found out about that episode and told the other parents, and he and his crew got the tongue lashing of a lifetime. You think torture is a game, and so on. Well, yeah, they did, actually. Though looking back now, Kareem can sort of see their point. When you're 7, 8, you make plastic explosives from Play-Doh and fill up matchboxes with rusty nails and tape it all onto a belt, and it's a fucking breeze to kill yourself. Then one day you're 11, 12, and you're a part of something real, more important than childhood, and more important than yourself. So he's been sort of indoctrinated by this extremist who lives in the camp. That's what that last part is referring to. So this is the guy who's adopting him. Him. Yes, the nun says, the boy in the red shirt. Jesus Christ, Christian. They are standing at a window looking out on a fenced, razor-wired area like the exercise yard of a prison. His adopted son has just walked off a bus, a kid at least 10 pounds underweight, whose flesh looks mildewed, who's hugging himself around the midriff as if to keep his guts from spilling out. I thought you knew, the nun asks. Yeah, but he's just a boy, I know. Come, I'll introduce you. Out of the building and across the dirt lot, when they get close, the kid sees them and forces himself to stand straighter. Will has had a lengthy inner debate about conduct in this moment. It's about the kid, not you. Empathy, big picture. Imagine you're 3 years old and you and your family get packed onto a cattle car and shipped off to a slum with no exit. 8 years later, you're the only one left, and some old white guy comes out of nowhere and expects you to call him father. Be cool and take it slow. The nun says, hello, Kareem. Hi, sister. Kareem, this is Mr. Banfelder. The kid looks up at Will with eyes big and tear-filled, not crying exactly. It's a symptom of withdrawal. Will kneels down in front of him and says, you're a dream addict. Yes, sir. How'd you get this stuff? He shrugs and hugs himself harder. Will reaches into the breast pocket of his coat and takes out a pack of greens. Marijuana is legal and, you know, being produced by tobacco companies. He shakes one out and hands it to the kid, then produces a disposable lighter. And the nun says, Mr. Banfelder, sister, I've seen this before. I knew a guy once back when I served who got into this shit. Said he never could have kicked it if it wasn't for grass. He lights the cigarette. The kid sucks and exhales, shivers, wipes his eyes. How long? 5 months, I guess. Will nods and lets the kid take a few more drags. Feel any better? A little. Mr. Banfelder, I don't think, opinion noted, sister, but Kareem is my responsibility now, legal guardianship and all that jazz. The nun gives a kind of smile. Then she says her goodbye to the kid, a hug and a kiss on the cheek. Then she shakes Will's hand and is off to her next good deed, which leaves the two of them. You called me sir, Will says. Yes, sir. Don't do that. Okay, says Kareem. So what then? You know Arabic. He nods. How about Jadi? The kid looks at him and wipes his eyes again. You speak Arabic. No. Jotty, the kid says, like grandfather. That makes sense? Sure. Okay then, Jotty it is. Finish the smoke and let's go. It's an hour to Sioux City. We'll get you some vitamins and a milkshake. All right, so I got one sort of longer final scene planned to read. I don't know what time it is, but.
Please.
Okay. All right, so this is later in the middle of the story. Again, I'm not gonna try to explain everything, but Kareem moves back to Dorian's neighborhood, and there's an altercation between Dorian and his friends. Well, it's actually, he goes there with one friend who's a black kid, and they get into a fist fight with the Muslim kids at the party. And after this, one of Dorian's sort of reactionary white friends gets in touch with this white supremacist organization because he wants them to help deal with the Muslims in the neighborhood. So these are the kids, Dorian's friends, hanging out one afternoon when this white supremacist guy comes by to talk to them. The kid who calls that guy is named Keenan, and that's the first name that is used in this section. Oh, and okay, so there's a reference here. The first line is Keenan Cartwright is a constant across all pathways. So I'm not reading anything right now that has to do with this aspect of the book, but as it goes on, there's a kind of discourse that develops about multiple timelines. So this first line has to do with the fact that whatever is going on in different timelines of the story, different versions of reality, this kid does not really change. Keenan Cartwright is a constant across all pathways. When given the option, he will always tell his counselor at lunch on that Monday what occurred at the pool party on Saturday. And by Tuesday, we'll be in receipt of an email from a representative of the local chapter of a nonprofit organization called the American Resistance Alliance. I'm sure you've heard of us. Keenan has not. But he needs no information beyond the profile picture on the group's lifebook page, the flag of the Islamic Caliphate going up in flames, to know that he, along with 3,582 other people, likes them, and that they should talk to Dorian. Which brings us to Wednesday. Same old drill. The four boys return home from their separate summer camps and convene at the in-law apartment. Today, Zebedee, this is, Dorian's really good friend. Today, Zebedee is first and claims prime real estate under an ancient window air conditioner as large, loud, and energy efficient as a jet propulsion engine. Second is Dorian, whose face, having taken a hit during a morning game of bombardment, is in a fresh state of pain. So he was hit by this kid Kareem at this party, like punched in the face. Last comes Dean, totally chonged, wearing a shirt with an iron-on marijuana leaf. Yo, Rastafari Mon, Keenan says. Hello, Mons. In your honor, Keenan says, we play some Old Testament. He scrolls on his handheld and switches to a song from the days before digital downloads. I shot the sheriff, but I did not shoot the deputy. I bet your grandma listened to this, Dorian says. So play something that doesn't suck. Sure, as soon as you do something that doesn't suck. Deal? Do, Plaxico says. Yeah, do, my Obama. About Saturday. You have any sodas? Dean asks. There's juice boxes. The grandfather clock plays Westminster chimes, strikes the hour of 5. There comes a knock on the sliding glass door. They can all see him. A guy much older than they. Probably a friend of the family, Dorian thinks, expecting when Keenan lets him in that he will shortcut without ceremony through the apartment. Instead, in a strangely official manner, he says, hello, gentlemen. Older than their brothers, though younger than their fathers, blonde hair so perfectly barbered it might be chipped from stone. In one hand, a tablet computer in a leather case. Let me guess, he continues. You're Dorian. Dorian nods. Then, in a tone somewhere between reassurance and disappointment, you don't look that severely fucked up. You should have seen him on Saturday, Keenan says. The guy ignores this and holds his hand out. "I'm John David," he says. And though some voice inside is saying, "Don't take it," Dorian can't see another choice. They shake, awkwardly, hands not quite locking together. Then he's requesting some bottled water, sitting down on the couch and saying, "Is there a smell in here?" "Prune juice," Dean says. Keenan, returning with the water, "Used to be my grandma's apartment." "You use this water exclusively?" "Yes." "He bathes in it," Dean says. From the look on his face, it's clear that John David doesn't find the comment very amusing. To Dean, he says, "You drink tap water." Dean shrugs. In this county alone, there are thousands of miles of unprotected pipeline. Any raghead with a bicycle pump and a grade school understanding of hydraulics could introduce botulism, plague, you name it, into the distribution system. See, there's this thing going on called World War III, or have you not heard of it? "Sorry," Dean says. As John David uncaps the water and takes a long drink, Dorian is thinking, "I know who he is. I've seen people like him downtown, standing on corners, handing out flyers. One time I accepted one, and my mother immediately took it out of my hands and crumpled it into a ball. But I shouldn't have to tell you guys. A battle was fought here," gesturing at the battered face. "Guess who lost?" "I wasn't there," Keenan says. "Dean, me neither." John David nods, as if these qualifiers are perfectly understandable. Then closing one eye, he says, "Well, where the fuck were you?" Dorian waits for his friends to explain about the Calypso Fest and the fractured femur, his excuses that the kids came up with to not go to this pool party with the Muslim kids. Some people think the war is in the Middle East, but the real war is right here, in America. You have to remember that, in the schools and in the backyards. There are four of you, there were four of them, correct? If you'd all been there, it would have been a fair fight. He takes the pad from the case. "Would, could, should. Let's talk names." "Abdel Karim," Keenan says. John David, fingers darting around the keyboard. "Last name?" "Hussein," Dean replies. Keenan shakes his head. "No, Hassad." "This is the kid across the street," John David surmises. "Father's name?" "Banfelder. House number? 13. "Okay," says John David. "The other three." Keenan gives Dorian a look. "What?" "He needs the names." "Can I ask a question?" Plaxico says. "Shoot." "You take these names, and then what?" "Kidnap the suspect, tie him down on his back, and you get to pour water over his face and into the breathing passages." "Are you fucking serious?" Keenan says. "No." Then, looking directly at Plaxico, "I'm with a watch group. We investigate incidents on a local level. I gather information, like names, and type it into a database. While we're on the subject, what's yours?" "Zebedee." "Very unusual." Dean says, "One of his ancestors got lynched." "About a millennium ago," adds Keenan. When John David asks Plaxico if this is true, Plaxico says, "Not 1,000 years ago, more like 80. Then John David, laying his tablet aside, asks in a very serious voice to hear the story, which all the boys know. "Mississippi Territory, 1959. Time of relatives they would never see except in the shifted hues of chromogenic photographs. Great-grandparents, great-uncles, and great-aunts. Great-uncle Zebedee, whose own great-grandfather, this was a whole other story, had sailed in chains from Africa to New Orleans. One afternoon, Zebedee runs out of gas on a dusty road, and a group of white men in a pickup truck offer to drive him into town. But what they actually do is take him away from town. They tie one end of a rope to the hitch of the truck and the other around his two hands, and they drive. They drive to a meadow, and with the same rope, hang him from a tree until dead." Thunder. Far off, but louder than the drone of the air conditioner, Dorian glances at the window. The sun is gone. Finally, it's going to storm. That, John David said, must have sucked. At least as much, possibly more, than getting abducted by Islamofascists and locked in a closet for several days, waiting to find out whether the United States government will agree to unconditionally surrender. And when it decides to not unconditionally surrender, you get your head cut off on videotape, and your body gets chopped into 10 pieces. Another rumble, closer this time. Let me ask you something. You're at the mall. You're gonna throw a penny in the fountain and make a wish. And when you step up to the railing, there's a pink backpack there, just sitting there, unattended. What do you do? Blue phone, Keenan says. John David, nodding. It could be some girl's school books, or it could be a remote-controlled bomb laced with radioactive medical waste. No responsible citizen turns away. Same thing here. Muslims being violent, you don't just turn away from that. The other day, it was a bloody nose and a black eye. Tomorrow, a knife, a gun, or worse. The other day, Dorian. Tomorrow, maybe you, Zebedee. Because this isn't about white or black. We're equal now. We're truly equal. Because there's an evil out there, and it wants every single one of us. He reaches for his tablet. Now, how about we get down to business, and you give me the rest of the goddamn names?